Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. I'd like to begin a brief series of lectures on the Jewish encounter with Rome. Today we're going to focus on the reign of King Herod, but I'd like to begin with the very first encounter with Rome, which actually takes us back to the days of the Maccabees. Here you can see a beautiful representation of Judas Maccabeus, or Yehuda Maccabee, one of the great military heroes of the revolt that occurred about the year 167 before the Common Era. Let's place his role in the encounter with Rome within its historical context. First, we've got to jump back just a little bit further to the reign of Alexander the Great, who, as you can see in this map, extended the empire he created from Macedonia, which is in the green on the left, all the way out through the Greek territories, Asia Minor, all the way through the Eastern Mediterranean, including Egypt, and then all the way out to northern India, Afghanistan. And after he died, this area was divided among four of his generals. You can see that the yellow color is the Seleucid Empire, and the sort of bluish-purplish that is dominant in Egypt, that would be the Ptolemaic Empire. And of course, Israel finds itself right in the middle of those territories. And one of the reasons why you can see in this particular map that the land of Israel is sort of colored yellow and purple is because it went back and forth between those two rival empires over the next century or so. We've spoken in other lectures about the Maccabean Rebellion, and I'm not going to go into it in great detail here, but let us just recall that there were many Jews living in the land of Israel who actively supported the Seleucid Greeks in their program to Hellenize the population, that is, to get the Jewish population in the land of Israel to absorb more and more Greek values, including everything from philosophy and science to athletics and aesthetics. And there was a feeling that this was like a modernizing thing that would bring Jews into the larger world of the Eastern Mediterranean in particular. And traditionalists argued against it, beginning with Mattathiah, who was Judah's father. And this created a kind of a traditionalist revolt against those Hellenizing Jews and against the Seleucid Greeks. Please feel free to have a look at some of my other lectures to get a better sense of how that conflict progressed. At any rate, the point where I'd like to pick it up here is where Yehuda Maccabee, who has taken over the command of the rebel forces, has effectively fought the Greeks to a stalemate. And the Seleucid general Lysias, now after the death of the previous king Antiochus Epiphanes, he proposes an armistice with the Maccabees, saying, okay, you know what, sorry we pushed you too hard, how about we find a compromise? We'll let you, for example, choose your own high priest, which was a major concern for a lot of the moderate population in Israel. So it turned out that the Hellenizing population in Israel and most of the moderates, they liked the idea. They wanted to end the war, not achieve full independence from the Seleucid kingdom, because they felt they're going to have to pay taxes anyways. As long as they were left alone, they had enough autonomy, especially religious autonomy, that was enough. But Yehuda Maccabee and his shrinking band of followers said that was not enough and insisted on fighting further. So the conflict at that point continued. A good portion of the Jewish population in Israel sought support of the Seleucids to try and, you know, end the fighting, whereas Judah Maccabee sends a delegation to Rome and says, hey, maybe Rome, you can help us out in our conflict with the Seleucids and in our ambition to achieve full independence. If you look at the Book of Maccabees, which does not appear in the Hebrew scriptures, but does appear in a lot of Christian Bibles in the Apocrypha section, this is, by the way, a beautiful reproduction of a 17th century English translation, the King James. And if we zoom in, we see this interesting passage. There's kind of like this header at the beginning. It says, Judas is informed of the power and policy of the Romans and maketh a league with them. And the articles of that league are described here. So the text talks about how Yehuda had heard of how powerful the Romans were and that he thought that he could enlist them into his aid against the Seleucids. If we jump ahead to the end of the chapter, it says here, verse 24, if there come any war upon the Romans or any of their confederates throughout all their dominion, the people of the Jews shall help them, right? This is like a mutual assistance treaty, as the time shall be appointed with all their heart. 26, neither shall they give anything unto them that make war upon them, meaning they will not help the enemies of the Romans at all, or aid them with victuals, weapons, money, or chips. And I wondered about that. Why are they not giving them chips? What's so important about the chips? It must be they had these great chips, Hal's. This is not, by the way, a paid product announcement. I actually like these chips a lot. So that was a joke. I'm sorry. I don't know why I put these things in there. But at any rate, let's go back. As it has seemed good unto the Romans, but they shall keep their covenant without taking anything therefor. So the idea was they signed a mutual assistance pact. The Jews would help the Romans if anyone attacked Rome, and theoretically at least, the Romans would help the Jews if anyone attacked Israel. Now, it turned out that it was more of a kind of a cynical agreement, and we don't, well, you'll see how it turns out. If you look at the Greek original, the text has both the Jews and the Romans virtually promising the same to each other, but it didn't work out that way. Meanwhile, the Seleucid kingdom lost control of Israel, and the Maccabees were able to actually achieve Yehuda Maccabees' dream of independence. He himself was killed in battle, but as you can see from this map, not only were the Maccabees able to establish a new dynasty called the Hasmonean kingdom or Hashmonaim, but they were actually able to expand it significantly throughout the region on the other side of the Jordan as well, and that's essentially the history of the Maccabean kingdom from the revolt in about the year 167 until the arrival of Pompey, a Roman general, and that's what we're going to turn to next. But to understand the nature of the Maccabean kingdoms, even though the Jews had a significant amount of independence, there was significant friction, and even though this was originally a rebellion against Greek values, the Hashmonaim gradually absorbed more and more of Greek ideas as well. And it kind of slid back into that Hellenizing frame over the next 100-odd years. Here you see, for example, a coin from Alexander Yanai, one of the most brutal of the kings of the era, a huge enemy to the rabbis. And as you can see from the right-hand side, the coin has an image of looks like a sun that's actually, in bas relief. It's actually extruded from the coin itself, which according to some rabbinic opinions would be directly forbidden as a kind of idolatrous image, like sun worship. At any rate, when he died in 76, there was a period of a rapprochement between the Maccabean leaders who had, claimed for themselves both the title of king and the title of high priest. His widow, Salome Alexandra, known affectionately as Shlomzion Hamalka in Hebrew, during her reign, there was actually a period of great rapprochement between the rabbis and the rulers, and it was a period of tremendous prosperity, which unfortunately ended under her sons. When she passed away, the region was thrown into a civil conflict once again. And that's what brought General Pompey to Israel, the first encounter of Rome with the land of Israel proper. The civil war that erupted between the sons of Alexander Yanai and Salome Alexandra, who were named Hyrcanus II, he was the elder, and he was the high priest, the Kohen Gadol. And his younger brother was Yehuda Aristobulus II, and both of them claimed rule. Hyrcanus II was the elder, but he was widely regarded as an ineffective leader. Yehuda Aristobulus was much more ambitious and apparently capable and wished to challenge his brother for the rule. Among other things, the idea that the role of Kohen Gadol and Melech, that is, high priest and king, should be separated. Both of the brothers ended up appealing to the Roman general Pompey, who was in the north at the time, for aid. Pompey looked at both of them, and he technically favored the weak Hyrcanus, but in reality, he just wanted to subjugate Judea to Rome. And when he came into the area, he nominally supported Hyrcanus, but in reality he took it over and in fact defiled the temple in a rather disgusting manner. This was in the year 63 before the Common Era. About 20 years later, Hyrcanus would ultimately be deposed by his nephew Antigonus, who was actually Aristobulus's son. According to Josephus, Antigonus actually bit off his uncle's ears, which mutilated him in such a way that he was no longer fit to serve as the Kohen Gadol, because there are certain laws about how the high priest has to appear. Rather nasty kind of event. But this means that from 63 before the Common Era, Rome is officially in charge of the land of Israel. Let us now turn a little bit later in time to the rise of one of the greatest kings of Israel in this era, King Herod. And when I say great, I'm not necessarily saying great in the sense of like wonderful, we love him, but great in the sense of being extremely powerful and leaving a huge mark on history. Perhaps he's best known in the Western tradition as being the author of the so-called Massacre of the Innocents, which is a passage that occurs in Christian scriptures in which he decrees the murder of all of these young children in an attempt to stave off the eventual birth of the figure that would be recognized by Christians as the Messiah. There's a lot of historical discussion about what that event might have been. We shall see shortly that it may actually be referring to Herod's murder of his own children, which was something he did with alarming frequency. At any rate, Herod was an Idumean. You can see the region of Idumea here is in the south of Judea. This is a region that was forcibly conquered by the Maccabean kings, and in a rare moment in Jewish history, the population was forcibly converted to Judaism. This is one of those moments that reverberates throughout history. Of course, Judaism has forsworn that particular practice, partially as a result of the horrible experience that they had under King Herod following this forced conversion. But at any rate, the Idumeans were a population that ultimately identified with the Jewish people, but they also felt somewhat separate and occasionally resentful of that. When we get a little further in the series, I'd like to discuss the role of the Idumeans in the First Roman Jewish War, which was quite significant. Herod's father was Antipater, who was an ambitious advisor to Hyrcanus. Herod was one of his multiple sons. He was born in the year 73, and his father, as a result of his attachment to Hyrcanus and the support of Rome, was able to give his sons political rule in various parts of the land of Israel. Herod was given the Galilee, the north, and he immediately charged in and used rather brutal means to put down an incipient rebellion that was happening there. He actually imposed the death sentence without the authorization of the Sanhedrin, which got him into trouble with the great Jewish court. And we have two parallel descriptions of a rather unusual event. It's mentioned in Josephus, who is, of course, one of the great historians of this era. Once again, I hope to discuss his complicated backstory a little later in the series, but he provides us an unusual glimpse into the moment when Herod was brought before the Sanhedrin to answer for his precipitous brutality in the Galilee. And we also have the same story with some significant differences in the Talmud as well. According to the version that Josephus offers, Herod appears before the Sanhedrin fully armed, which was considered a great act of nerve, to use the Hebrew term chutzpah. It was a great act of insolence to appear before the great court wearing armor. And he effectively cowed all of the judges into submission, and essentially they let him go without any kind of reprimand. In the Talmudic version, which you can see here, appears on page 19b of Tractate Sanhedrin. In the Talmudic version, it is Shimon ben Shetach, who is the great rabbi who stands up against Alexander Yanai, the king, and challenges his colleagues. But in the Josephan version, it is none other than the great Shammai, the interlocutor to Hillel, who was the only rabbi who has the courage to stand up to Herod. But unfortunately, he is not supported by the rest of the Sanhedrin, and Herod walks. Why these two versions, Josephus and the Talmud, differ in the important details of which figures are speaking is beyond the scope of this discussion. Herod brought three particular skills to his rule in the land of Israel, and we'll see them play out over his long career. The first is that he was capable of bold, brutal repression, that he had very little qualms about using violence to support his rule. Secondly, and ironically, this was combined with a remarkable level of public generosity, that he was certainly capable of recognizing the needs of the larger population and to provide for their tax relief and grain whenever possible, and especially, as we shall see shortly, in a massive series of public building works that were designed quite often for public benefit. So this combination of being very brutal and bold and at the same time very generous is rather unusual, and certainly helped to promote his rule. And the third skill that he possessed was he was an extremely shrewd cultivator of relationships and alliances, particularly early in his life. He was very, very careful and able to thread the needle between various Roman factions and to find supporters and patrons and know when to genuflect and when to fight back. He was able to secure his realm primarily because of these three skills: bold, brutal repression, remarkable public generosity, and his shrewd cultivation of relationships and alliances. Thank you very much for watching.